ignoring the will of the population is normal, so it's not, happens all the time. What's a little more interesting about the Iran case is that the United States is also ignoring the will of major sectors of corporate interest that have a special interest in the Middle East. The energy corporations would be delighted to have the threats end and to be able to exploit Iranian oil, but they're being disregarded too. Now that's a little more unusual. It happens, but it's unusual. And it tells us something about how state power is exercised and why. In fact, there is a state interest in isolating and undermining Iran that overrides the usual commitment to the interests of concentrated private power. It's something that you might call the Mafia principle, a sensible principle. Disobedience can't be tolerated. It's if a storekeeper doesn't pay his protection money, the godfather has to do something about it. It may not need the money, but you cannot accept disobedience. It's a disease that can spread. Others can do it too. So you have to control it. In fact, the real reason for the, I mean, Iran, the regime is rotten to the core, but that's not the reason why the U.S. is hostile, supports much worse regimes. Actually, the real reason was explained pretty eloquently by the editors of the New York Times back in 1953, when the United States and Britain overthrew the parliamentary government in Iran and instituted a brutal tyrant. The editors explained that this is a great thing. They said it's an object lesson to underdeveloped countries with rich resources that go berserk with fanatical nationalism, and it'll teach leaders of other such countries lessons in decent behavior. Now, that's a clear expression of the Mafia principle in an issue of great significance, namely the what were called the stupendous resources of the Middle East. Thinking at the time in the government was that if we can control Middle East oil, we can control the world. And we don't want anyone going berserk with fanatical nationalism and stealing our resources from us. Well, those are real reasons. That's it's a leading theme of world control, gets much too little attention. The Indian nuclear weapons program received a major boost from the United States by the United States nuclear deal a year ago, which allows India to receive aid for its nuclear programs. And of course, that transfers at once to military, to nuclear weapons programs. Pakistan's nuclear weapons are a gift to the world from Ronald Reagan because of his part of his strong support for the most vicious and brutal dictator in Pakistan's history, Zia-ul-Huq, who was also carrying out the radical Islamization of Pakistan with consequences that are quite familiar today. And the Reagan administration pretended that they, of course they knew, but they pretended that they didn't know that Pakistan was developing nuclear weapons so they could continue to support Zia and the radical Islamization of Pakistan. Israel, there's no need to comment. It's also worth noting that they're not alone. There's another beneficiary of U.S. support for nuclear weapons development. That's Iraq under Saddam Hussein. He was a favorite of Reagan and Bush number one. And in fact, a few months before his invasion of Iraq, Bush one invited Iraqi nuclear engineers to the United States for advanced weapons training. It's an interesting story, another one of those that's kept under wraps. Well, no sane person wants Iran to have nuclear weapons, or for that matter, anyone. But the manufactured hysteria about this is pure hypocrisy. The real threat, the major threat, is the non-signers of the Non-Proliferation Treaty, Israel, India, and Pakistan, and their superpower patron. That's what the story would be in a free press.